Maybe you have your own blog. Maybe it's a blog that you monetize. Maybe it's a blog for your hobby and you don't want to monetize it. But the one thing every successful blog has in common is that it publishes. And if you don't publish, you're not successful. So we want to make sure that you have never run out of ideas. So that is not an excuse for you, because you're always going to have enough ideas. And as we go through this, keep in mind your own goals for your website. Because some of these ideas may work for you, I hope so, and some may not, but that's okay. So just always keep your own ideas in mind. And, you know, before we get into how to find ideas, let's make sure that we conserve your writing, conserve your content. So one of the ways to make sure that you don't run out of ideas is don't overwrite. So maybe you're running out of ideas because your posts are too long. You might be writing more often than you should, or that kind of thing. So first of all, we'll talk about not overwriting. So people want posts that are short and easy to read, and they can just get the information they want and get in and get out. And that's really not anything new. People have been talking about that in journalism for 30 years. And here's a post that I did a while back. Usually I write 500 to 1,000 words. This one was very short. It's about 200 words. And you can see it just got a big picture, and it's got a little bit of content there, and that's all there is to it. It doesn't need, we're not in fifth grade anymore, when your teacher said you have to write 10 sentences or you need 100 words. There is no minimum amount of words or content that you have to have. You could have a picture with a caption. So if you are writing posts that are very long, it might be that you want to write in-depth posts, and that's okay. But maybe you're thinking, well, I'm going to write 12 tips on how to save money. Well, you could do that if that fits into your goals. But maybe you want to take that and focus it more, because people want very focused content. So maybe you're going to do 3 tips on saving money at the supermarket, and 3 tips on saving money when you go on vacation. And then you have a couple different posts. And so you're not running out of ideas because you're focusing your content more. Okay, so some exceptions are, if it works with what you're writing about. So here is an article that I wrote that is very long. So it's really hard to find plants for shady gardens that have flowers on them. And a go-to flower for years and years was a plant called impatience. And people, it was cheap, and everybody planted it. And then a disease started killing this plant off. So I had to tell people about what the disease was, how it affects your plant, and then give them alternatives for plants that work in shade, because there aren't a lot of flowering plants that work in shade. And so this is very long, and I considered making 2 posts out of it. It's super long, lots of lists, lots and lots of pictures. And I thought, well, like, always put yourself in your reader's shoes. So my readers do not want to wait until next week to find out what else they have to plan. They don't want to read 2 separate articles about it. They want all their options in one article. That's what I decided. So I made it very long. So always think about, what does my reader want? So this article is almost 2,000 words. It has 11 photos, but I made it one long post because it was necessary for the content. So don't steer away from long articles. I'm not telling you to never write long articles. But don't think that you have to have a minimum word length for a post. So just say what you need and get out. Okay, now, you might be running out of ideas for blog posts, because you write too often. So how often should you post? Well, it depends on what your goals are and what you're reading. maybe I want to talk to them 2 or 3 times a week. They don't want to hear from me that office that often, and I don't have the capacity to do it that often anyway. So keep in mind those things to figure out how often you should be writing. And remember that this is a marathon, not a sprint. It's more important to find a pace that you can keep up for months and years. Because if you say, yeah, I'm going to blog every week, and then you get busy or an emergency comes up and you miss one post, that makes it real easy to miss another one and miss another one. And then guess what? You're not blogging anymore. So make sure you find a pace that works for you. So where do we find content overnight? Well, so first of all, look at what's in the news. You know, just be aware of what's happening in the world around you, wherever you get news in the world. But then also look at news in your field, whatever it is you're blogging about. So where do you find that kind of news? Might be other blogs in your field. So look to them. What are they talking about? Maybe those are the things I should be talking about as well. Maybe you read national blogs and you have a local blog and you can do a local angle on what the national blog is talking about. Maybe you need to read scientific journals to give information to your reader and get ideas. Trade publications. So you may not realize that in pretty much every industry, every business, there is some kind of magazine written for that niche. So look and see what they're talking about. That could give you ideas. Okay, get on lists from public relations offices. They send out press releases. These are very nicely written documents, and they will have news in them and ideas. It's all written up, and they send it to you. And they can also be sources of photos. So if you need a photo, some kind of image to go with it, they may be able to supply that as well. So if they don't include a photo, ask for one. So what kind of places will give you press releases? Well, first of all, companies. So if manufacturers, suppliers, so maybe if you do tech, maybe you want to get, what new gadgets are coming out? So you want the manufacturers to let you know what's coming up next so that you can tell your readers about it. If you're a landscaper, maybe your suppliers have some information about their products, about their tiles or their concrete or things like that, that it will be interesting for your readers to know about. New products, of course. Nonprofits can also be a source. So for me, with my magazine, the Botanical Gardens, the Buffalo and Erie County Botanical Gardens, they send me press releases because they're always doing something. And that's a great source for me. Cornell Cooperative Extension, they have gardening news. And they have different cooperative extensions in different counties, and they will send me news. Sometimes they'll send me whole stories. So groups that hold events that your readers might be interested in attending, check those out. And then even the government. So for me, the State Department of Environmental Conservation sends out press releases on new things that they're doing. Maybe they need volunteers. Maybe there's a new bug that we have to be aware of, or a new invasive plant. When not to use fertilizer on your lawn, so things like that. So look for government agencies that might affect what you're doing. Okay, act like a reporter. So if you go to conventions or conferences or workshops, don't just go like a tourist and sit back and relax. Take notes. So if it's something that you could possibly be writing about, something that your readers would be interested in knowing, take notes. Take a picture. Maybe it's the person is a scientist or something, and it's a big figure, and your readers would be interested in hearing about this person, but maybe the talk is too technical. So you could go up afterwards and ask a question that your readers would be interested in knowing about. You know, like, oh, something is happening. happening in Western New York, in our field, what do you think about that? And then you could write that answer and say, oh, this distinguished person from our field came to Western New York, and this is what he or she had to say about this problem that we are interested in. So if there's not an event coming up, find somebody you can interview. So maybe you work for a company. You could interview an employee and write about an employee, and your readers would get to know somebody in your company. A customer testimonial. So you interview a customer, and they say, oh, here's how this company helped me, and that's going to help other potential customers. If there's somebody in your field that you would like to interview, but they don't live around here, well, pick up the phone and call them. And you'd be surprised at how many people would be willing to give you a short interview. Now, make sure that you make a list of questions before you make that phone call. And obviously, you may want to contact them by email first to get permission to do the interview, by email or text or whatever. So you're going to make up a list of questions. What do you want to ask the person so that you're not stumbling? And make sure that you get their name spelled right, and make sure that you get a title. Sometimes people will have multiple titles. You may have to pick one or two that are pertinent to the topic. For instance, a faculty member may have a title as the faculty member at the university, but then they also have a title with the center that they're working at, and they have other titles. So get that information, get a couple quotes. You could ask the person for a photo of themselves or a photo of them doing whatever it is you're talking about, you know, something in the field, that would be great. Questions from readers. If a reader sends you a question, wow, that's great, because this is something, now you absolutely know what readers are interested in because one of them asked you. And so this is, if one reader is interested, probably another reader is interested as well. If you're not sure what people might want to read about, well, what about questions that people ask you all the time? If you work for a retail space, what questions do people ask you? Every one of those could be a blog post, every single question. And then when that question comes up again, you can refer back to it. So it could be, what does this word mean? What is this technical term? You know, what is this plant? You know, things like that. If you have more than one person in your group or your nonprofit or your company, ask those folks for ideas. What do they think that our readers want to know? What kinds of questions do they get? And then upcoming events. So maybe you're going to be holding an event. Well, of course you're going to be. If you are holding an event, you're going to be sending out several, you're going to be doing several blog posts saying, hey, 6 months from now we're doing an event, hey, it's getting closer, sign up, all those sorts of things. Maybe you're just going to be exhibiting at a trade show or something like that. Well, that's okay. Say, hey, come to the trade show, say hi, you know, let them know that you're going to be there at an event. Maybe there is an event that your readers should be going to. Well, obviously, you're going to tell them about that. Especially if you are going to be participating or speaking, let people know. That positions you as something of an expert. And so you want that kind of prestige. If you get a lot of events that you want to tell your readers about, you may want to run a calendar. And what's nice about that is it keeps your website updated even more than if you just post once a week. You may be posting events more often than that. Okay, if you can help me out, I am going to love you. So any kind of advice or tips that you can give to your readers, that's going to be great. If you can solve a problem for your readers, that's going to be stupendous. So there are some things that you probably know off the top of your head. Or maybe it's something that somebody else in the company knows and you can just get the information from them. Or you can interview somebody else. So put yourself in your reader's shoes. Okay, so you can also share So they recently changed, and now they're posting those articles on their website. And so what they do is when those articles are posted on their website, they let me know, and then I write a blog post and say, hey, there's new material, and here are the articles that you can see here. And, whoops, and, here we can see it here. And I don't, I do, okay, so I have here quoted somebody, the person who wrote this article. But I'm not putting a whole article here. But I'm using a little bit of the article here. And then I link back to the website. So you can do that. And then you can read the whole article here. So don't plagiarize people, but you can link to other websites. And you could do a post that says, hey, here are five other websites that you might be interested in, or five blogs that you might be interested in reading. That would be a good post in itself. Okay, holidays. So, New Year's. Everybody can do something with New Year's, no matter who you are and what your blog's about. So you can do something about the year in review. This was what happened in our field last year. And or you can do something next year. Here are the trends that we expect to see. Okay, so everybody can do something with New Year's. Thanksgiving. Are you thankful for your readers? Tell them. I like you. Thank you for subscribing. I really appreciate it. People like to be thanked. They like to feel appreciated. And then we've got lots and lots of quasi-holidays. How about National Popcorn Week? Okay, maybe that will help you. I've actually written something about National Popcorn Week for a different publication when we were very desperate. So, there. Everybody had the flu and we were down staff and it was really hard, but we needed it. So it worked. But you may have your lists of these quasi holidays. Find something that works for you. Tax Day. Okay, maybe that's not a holiday, but maybe that is important to what it is that you write about. And then holidays for you. Maybe the anniversary of your starting your blog, or something like that. So some anniversary for you. Timely events, a new pope is elected, something like that. The president visits Buffalo, or the gasoline prices go up, or gasoline prices go down. Does this mean something to your industry, to your field? So watch for those, write about those. Seasons, the first day of spring, or boy, you know, it's really hard for everybody to get to work because of the snow. So those kinds of things, watch for those. Is there something there that you can write about? And then interesting facts, look for these. If you had to write a blog for a plumber, you could say plumbing comes from the Latin word for lead because lead was used in pipes. And then maybe you can go off of that and say, well, we don't use lead in pipes anymore, we use PVC or whatever. So find an interesting quote and an interesting fact. So you may be able to just use the fact, and that could be your blog post, or maybe it can be an inspiration and a starter and something that you can build on. And then quotes, you know, in something inspirational, something funny, but it depends on what your website's about. So maybe your website is a little edgy, so maybe you want a sarcastic quote from somebody. You know, something current. Whatever it is, look for those kinds of quotes. And announcements. So maybe you're going to be giving a talk, or you're offering a new service, or you're running a contest. So any of those things, you're going to definitely make an announcement to your readers. Maybe you've gotten an award. Okay, now don't wait until you get the Pulitzer, okay? Any award is okay. So I am a Constant Contact All-Star. So Constant Contact gives out awards if you have a high open rate, and I think also some of the criteria are like that I make sure that I delete emails of non-existent addresses and things like that. So I let people know I'm a about, well, it's also because I delete, you know, non-existent addresses. You don't have to tell them that part. And it, you know, and people, you know, so it doesn't have to be a stupendous award. Maybe you belong to a business group and it's small and there's a business of the month and it's your turn, so you get to be business of the month. Well, don't tell them that, yeah, everybody gets to be business of the month. You know, you can say, hey, I was business of the month. So anything like that, let people know about. You know, if you received a new certification, maybe the local paper or TV station did a story with you. Let people know. Oh, thank you, readers. If I didn't have subscribers, I wouldn't have any interest from advertisers. So I'm very thankful for my readers, and I thank them for their loyal support often. People like to feel appreciated. So I do this when I've added a new bunch of subscribers, like if I have a table at an event and I've signed up a couple hundred subscribers, so I let people know, you know, thanks for signing up. And that makes them feel welcome. Now, call to action. I just want to check my time here. Okay, so this isn't, it could be a thing on its own, it could be a post on its own, or it could be something that's in a blog post, okay? A call to action is when you tell your reader what it is you want them to do, okay? So it might be, please subscribe, please tell your friends to subscribe, please buy something, please register for an event, please sign this petition, please like me on Facebook. So any of those things could be a call to action. So you may do a separate post telling, reminding people, hey, you know, please tell your friends to subscribe to us, or we're having a contest, so please tell your friends to subscribe to us, that kind of thing. And even when it isn't its own separate post, try to slide those in whenever you can into the bottom of an article to let people know what it is you want them to do. If you're going to write about a petition that's important to your readers, tell them at least once somewhere in that article, please go to this website and sign it. Don't just give them the URL. Tell them, go and sign it, okay? And it's amazing how just saying, just directing people will get a better response. If you have merchandise and you have lots of it, you shouldn't run out of blog ideas because you have another, you know, another item to write about every single time. Maybe you don't have merchandise. Maybe you offer services. So what can you do? Well, say here is one way that my service is going to make your life easier. And then in another blog post, here is a different way that my service is going to make your life easier. Product reviews are obviously another way. You can always find another product to review. Okay, so tell stories. Now, whenever you have an anecdote, it doesn't have to be a funny anecdote, but some story. People really respond to stories. I think humans are hardwired for this. So if you had an interaction with a customer, you may want to write a story about that. Okay, for example, a customer had a problem. They came to you, you did this, this, and this, it solved their problem, and now this is the result. Okay, there were three steps to that. People often, when they try to write these kinds of stories, they'll say, oh, this person had a problem, and they'll go on and on and on about the problem. And then they came to us, and then now they, you know, they're millionaires, and they skip the whole middle part. And about, well, how did you help them? What was it that helped them? So don't forget the middle part. That's the most important part, is how you helped them. Not just how awful it was and how great it is now, but how you helped them. If you are telling a friend an interesting story, oh, you know what happened at work today? And you're telling a friend, maybe, think about it, maybe that could be a blog post. So consider that. Now, videos are not really a different idea for stories, but it's a different way of presenting content. And if you're not a writer, or you don't like writing, or it's intimidating to you, videos may be helpful to you. The quality does not have to be high. You know, so look at look it's not super shaky and you can hear people, then you're probably okay. People will tolerate pretty low quality if it has good information that they want. You have to get it all in one, like film it completely, get it right in one take, or you have to edit it. So editing does take time. There are lots of different ways to edit. There are editing applications, but it takes a lot of time. It eats time up. So if you can do it in one take, that would be great. So if you wanted to interview somebody in your group, and you're just asking some questions back and forth, and you ask one question, and the guy just goes on, and you know he said it well, and he's answered all your questions, you may be done, and you don't have to do a whole lot of editing. So that may work well for you. It's good for interviews. It's super for how-to, because it's really hard to write. Well, take that straight thingy over here, and then you've got the round thingy over here. You know, it's really hard to describe how to do something, but if you have a video that says, look, I'm gonna take this and this and do this, people can follow it. It's so much easier. You can do just audio, which of course is called a podcast, and there's gonna be a talk on podcasts later today. So those are some possibilities if you don't like writing. Okay. So once you have done those, once you've done a lot of these, you can start to reuse your own material, which is great. So I've done lots and lots of articles, and here's one that I posted in 2014, but I post one pretty much like this pretty much every fall. So this one is about leaves, and the first tip it links back to something that I had already written about. So it's like this was an article that I had done in the winter that said, well, if your plants are heaving out of the ground, it's probably because you didn't mulch them with leaves. You should have mulched them with leaves in the autumn. So that was one that links back to something I had already done. And then this next one also links back to something I had already done. Hey, you want to, here's another use of leaves, and this was a video that I had done. So once you have compiled a lot of articles, you can do a post that says, here are five things to do in autumn, or something like that. So it's great, you can reuse your own material. And you know, every 2 years, everything is new. And sometimes people need to be reminded every year, because I have new readers all the time, people's gardens change, people didn't read that article that I did 4 years ago. So. And even if they did read it, they don't remember it. So before I post my articles, I ask my sister to read them. And often she will say, oh yeah, I really like that information about such and such. And I said, Maxine, I used it last year. And she doesn't even remember it. She reads them very closely because she proofs them for me. So it's okay. People will not remember. They don't pay as much attention to your articles as you think or hope they would. So definitely refer back to information that you've already used. Okay, and so this I think is really, really important, is as you get ideas, put them into an editorial calendar. So what you're gonna do, here's what I have. So this is very messy. I think an Excel spreadsheet would work well. So I just put in the left column my dates. It's actually a little bit less messy today, because when I put this in my file, I wasn't sure what I was going to run this coming Tuesday. I put in things that I think I might want in there. And I have things for next autumn or for next year, because I didn't get a chance to run them this year. So if you get an idea, oh gee, there was some balance And you can even write, you can write it ahead of time so that you have it in place. So this helps you schedule and know what's coming up. And if you can write some articles, some posts, or do videos that are not timely, that aren't associated with a holiday or a certain season, that can be run anytime, that's stupendous. Because if you get sick, if an emergency comes up, you have something all set and ready to go, and you can just hit publish and boom, it's there. So if you can do that, that would be stupendous. And so I hope that this has helped you think of some ways that you might find new articles and new ideas for your blog posts. So does anybody have questions or ideas on?
Yes, how do we get a copy of your slides or do you have a link here?
I will ask, yes, I don't know. I can link them. That's a very good question.
Or, I can answer that.
Yes.
Usually speakers will put it up on SlideShare or a service like that.
Okay.
The organizers will take them. They usually put them on the website of the camp afterwards.
Yeah, I thought they might be on the, if they're not on the website of WordCamp, I'll find out.
So the same website you use to register and go in a couple of days and all the slides for all the questions will be on there?
Yeah, typically. That'd be a question we ask for organizers, but that's what typically happens, yeah. Or they send them out in an email to attendees afterwards.
All right, great.
Or you know what, if they don't, you know, just come up afterwards and I'll get your information. I'll make sure I send them to you.
Okay. I have another question. You do a lot of writing, a lot of blog posts and everything. Do you have a safe place or a good place for your images where you're not going to get in trouble with copyright or some neutral place to get your images from?
Okay, so where do we get images is the question.
Yeah.
Okay, first of all, I take a lot of my own photos. So as soon as I take that photo, I own the copyright to that photo. And I don't have to send it to Washington or anything to get a copyright. I own the copyright to that. And therefore, you have to assume that any photo you see on the internet, somebody else owns the copyright to that. So do not right-click and just take their photos. So where do you get photos? It depends on what you're looking for. So if you want just, you know, kind of random things, Unsplash is very good. It's Unsplash, UNSPLASH. And there are some others. Some people say Pixabay, but I'm not sure I trust them, because if you read their information, they'll say, oh yes, you can use this and you don't have to pay us or anything like that. But then in their information, it seems like they sort of shrug their shoulders and say, well, but if people have uploaded photos to us that they really didn't own the copyright to, and they really didn't, they weren't supposed to, and you use it, oh, too bad for you. That's how it feels to me. So I'm not too sure, but Unsplash is pretty good about it.
And there's another story idea, which isn't really covered, but if you have a bunch of photos, you can write a story or an article based on your photo. You know, if you have like 20 photos, you went on a trip, or you did something, and you know, that gives you a story idea, too, a blog idea.
Yeah, so just a bunch of photos can be a story. And a lot of the articles that I'm doing now, I used to have a lot of text with them, but now, because I go out to gardens and I take pictures of the gardens and there's this plant and that plant and an overview and, you know, the back deck. But of course, the pictures can tell the story. So I don't need, if I have five pictures, and I don't need as much copy, because you're looking at the pictures, I don't need to explain it to you. So yeah, you could just do, you know, here are five pictures that show something. But do not just take them from somebody else's website. And I guess I'm very vehement about this because my photos get stolen a lot and I don't appreciate it. So don't just do that. The other thing is, if you're looking for a specific picture, there might be websites that can help you. For instance, there's one called Bugwood, B-U-G-W-O-O-D. of bugs and plants and plant diseases. So if you needed a specific, not just a tree, but you needed a certain variety of maple tree, you could find it there. And that is free. Okay, but you have to get permission to use them and all that kind of thing. Then there are things like, for, again, in my field, ball horticultural or proven winners. So that if I wanted a picture, not just, you know, of some kind of a plant, but a very specific variety of a certain plant, I could go to those and they have a photo library. But I can only use those if I'm talking about that specific plant. I can't just use it and say, oh, here's a pretty picture of a garden. I have to be talking about that plant. Let's see. But there are a lot, and if you, and Wikimedia. So Wikimedia. So there are some photos there that you can use. And again, you know, because it's Creative Commons and you don't have to pay. Of course, there are places where you can find photos that you do pay for, and it may be worth it to pay, depending on what it is you're looking for and what you need. Let's see. You know, and just take a photo yourself if you can. You know, if you take a photo yourself, you're good. Yes?
Two tools that, especially with the blog, an editorial calendar up. Two tools that are very helpful are Google Trends. It'll tell you the different, you know, you just put a search term in, I think it's trends.google.com or google.com/trends. But you can search in that, and it'll tell you when topics are popular, associated search terms, so maybe you're not searching the right thing. And then I set Google Alerts that are emailed to my inbox for various subjects. If I'm going to be doing a story on minimalism, I'll set up a Google alert for minimalism, and I can tell it to send me stories as they appear in search, a weekly digest, or what have you. And then I just save that one and put my story in there.
Yeah. Did everybody hear all that?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, that's stupendous. Thank you. That's great.
Thank you.